Number two, God wants to make you a channel of blessing. He wants to make your channel blessing to your descendants. Verse number eight, that you may possess the good land and pass it on as an inheritance in your descendants forever. You cannot give what you don't possess, right? If you don't have it, you can't give it away. So that you may possess first. God wants you to possess something so that you can pass it on. I possess in this temple faith that tells me I have everlasting life. When Brother Richard dies, I will gain. I want my children to have the kind of things. Don't you? Well, people are looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the overtaker. That's faith. I want my kids to have the kind of perspective. When a door slams shut in my face, I don't want to sit down and, oh, poor me. On the contrary, I want to see if there's another open door here. Or maybe another open door here, my God Almighty, amen? I want to be positive, not negative, amen? When my body begins to ache, Sister Marina went to see the doctor, right? And some of you have had others, when my body begins to ache, that ought to just remind me that I'm just passing through, right? Just passing through. The body of humiliation. I'm getting to where I think I need a hearing aid. At least that's what my wife tells me. And it's just a reminder. It's just a reminder that we're passing through, right, Brother Gerald? Just passing through. I want my kids to have that kind of perspective. So more is come than taught. If I possess it, I will profess it. And if I possess it and profess it, my kids most likely will also profess it. And possess it. So pass it on. Somebody say, pass it on. Don't live like a clown. Don't live like a turkey. Don't live like a pessimist. Live like you know your God is in heaven and reigns and rules forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
You remember hearing the story? You know who Martin Luther, Martin Luther, the reformer, Martin Luther. There was a time when Martin Luther was so down on things that were happening against just about everybody, the whole religious establishment, everybody was down on him. And he was kind of despondent, in fact, depressed. Have you ever been down? Have you been depressed? Have you been despondent? And his wife looked at him, and he was there just for the longest time, just, I mean, day after day. So finally, his wife got encouraged enough to say that, I'm so sorry to hear that your God has died. God has died. What do you mean my God's not there? But it sure looks like it. Look at you. Has your God died? Is your God dead? Is he alive? See, we want to possess that and pass it on to our loved ones. Number two, not only acknowledge God, but serve God. Simple, yet profound. Simple, yet essential. There's two ways to serve God. Two ways. Right out of the Bible. Holy Spirit is better. Better than what we can put together. Serve Him with a wholehearted devotion. With wholehearted devotion. One of the translations says with a complete heart, perfect heart. In other words, not 50-50. Not, I'll be in church if I have nothing else to do. I'll give an offering if I have anything left over. I'll pray. I had the other day, I've heard more than once, people say when they cannot sleep, they read the Bible. I said, oh my goodness, the Bible's not supposed to put you to sleep. It's supposed to awaken you, amen?
Amen.
Don't read the Bible to fall asleep. Read the Bible to be ready for the good fight of faith, amen?
Amen.
So, you don't pray if you don't have anything else today. You don't come to church if you're, no. Serve God with them. There's got to be a decision inside, a devotion, wholehearted devotion. That's how you serve Him. And then with a willing mind, there's got to be this disposition God, I love you. God, I want you. I want to be in relationship with you. I want to honor you. And Paul said it like this. In all things, it is my aim to please God. That's a willing mind. There's two reasons why you and I ought to serve God with a willing, with a wholehearted devotion and willing mind. First of all, for the Lord searches everyone. The Lord searches everyone. Now ponder, you know. This is a day of instant potatoes. We're not making instant potatoes yet. We're interested in growing in the Lord. He searches every heart. I don't know how many people find themselves in this place today, but every heart is searched by God, even by God. Go ahead. Yes, sir. That can be good, or they can be not so good. Because number two, not only does it search the heart, but God, for the Lord, understands every motive behind the thoughts. That can be good if you're serving Him with wholehearted devotion. It can be great if there's a willingness of mind, or it can be not so good if you're giving Him leftovers. Number three, be strong. Be strong into it. Be strong in what?
Yeah.
I didn't hear you. Be strong in
it.
Yeah. Do it. Just do it. Well, Brother Richard, I don't understand everything, but just do it. I've always believed that you will grow as you go. I've always believed that He will shed light on your path as you press on. And the word, how does that scripture go? Somebody help me. Somebody help me now. The word of the Lord is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. A lamp unto my feet. Can you see my feet? And a light. A light unto my feet, and a lamp unto my path. So I can see my feet, and then as I move forward, that lamp will last. And because I can see, there's not anything about the back, but you're moving forward, right? Just like the armor of God. There's no armor for your back, no room for retreat. So move forward, amen? Move forward, Christian soldier. Onward, Christian soldier. We're moving forward, we're moving forward. So again, acknowledge God, be strong, and do it. Now before you build for God, here's a suggestion. Draw near to God. If not, it'll be hay, wood, snow. If I don't draw near to God and there's no intimacy, there's no genuine relationship there, then basically all it is activity. See, I move around and I go to different churches and I mingle with different people and I approach people. I'm a type A personality. I don't wait for people to come to me. I go to people, I talk to them. And I always want to find out their spiritual condition. And there's so many people, and even if they go to church, are not in intimacy with God. They may know about God without knowing God. They may know all the religious jargon and all of the religious activity of a church. But if you're not related with God, guess what? So before I build for God, I need to draw near to God. Because when the fire comes and I'm tested, I want to make sure that what I'm building will last. That's why it says acknowledge God. Acknowledge God. But you've got to do it with wholehearted devotion. Then do the work. This way first. This way, and then that way. You see, this way, acknowledge it. Then wholehearted devotion inside. Have you ever thought to yourself that wherever you go, you take yourself? Richard, you're insulting my intelligence. But wherever you go, you take yourself. So if it's not right like this, guess what? There's going to be something missing. And guess what? Even if I do it that way, serve that way, there'll be a missing link. And you want the kids, and you want people to know that you're real. Have you ever been around people and something says, you know, that guy's for real. That gal is for real. See, that's that something about this way first, then this way. So before you build, draw near. Now, acknowledge God, wholehearted devotion, and of course, do it. The next one is not only build for God, but number two, I learn from others' mistakes, but imitate their good qualities. Imitate. Now, there's not a one of us in this place that can say we have a perfect daddy or a perfect mommy or a perfect parents. The other day we celebrated a pastor's, in fact, a couple of years ago we celebrated a pastor's anniversary. And all of his kids and grandkids were there. As we were celebrating their anniversary, I had the pleasure of saying to them, I'm so glad that your kids are here now. Because now your kids are discovering that it's not easy to raise kids. And then I turned to the kids and I said to the kids, I'm sure that by now you're discovering that just like your parents made mistakes, you make your own mistakes, right? And just like you challenge your parents, I'm sure you're being challenged by your kids. You know, the devil likes to remind us of all the bad stuff that we've done, all the faults and all the flaws in our lives. Now, while God is after your soul, the devil's after your mind. The world is after your body. But the devil wants to work on your mind. And the devil wants to remind you of the mistakes you made. You're not a good daddy. You're not a good mommy. You're not a good son. You're not a good daughter. What's wrong? So you can be overwhelmed with guilt. And I would say to us, all of the people that surround us, and all of the mistakes they made, learn from those mistakes. Learn from the mistakes. If somebody has not been affectionate, learn from it and you be affectionate. If someone has not been very caring in your life, learn from that and be very caring. If you've lived around a Scrooge and a Scrooge, and learn from those mistakes. If you've lived around people that don't go to church, don't think about God, they use their mouth for lying and deception and cursing, learn from those mistakes. But I'm sure if you look long and hard, and if you look past a lot of that stuff, you'll see that even those individuals have good qualities. Imitate those good qualities. The old phrase is, don't throw out the baby with the dirty water. Don't be so mad at your dad or mad at your mommy or mad at your grandparents that you won't learn from them. We all have something to contribute. Amen? Amen? If you live long enough, you make a bunch of mistakes. And there's a golden rule that says, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. So be forgiving. Amen? Learn from their mistakes, but imitate the good qualities. And I would say, we've got so much to learn. That's why the word consider now. Consider now. Consider now, for the Lord has chosen you to build a temple as a sanctuary. I happen to believe that he wants to help us to move us away from, to move us to a victorious mindset. So we might overcome a victim mentality. You know, well, my daddy was like this, and that's why I am. I grew up in this environment. Or nobody loves me, nobody cares for me, nobody understands me. That's a victim mentality. Move away from them in the name of Jesus and become a victorious individual. Amen? Number three, receive the encouragement, and excuse the typo there, encouragement and direction others give you. Receive the encouragement and direction others give you. Daddies were always given advice, encouragement, and providing direction. I pray they were giving good encouragement. I pray they were giving good direction. Notice what that David said to Solomon. Be strong and do the work. That's it. Try to be encouraged. Be strong, my son. Be strong. You know, just man up. You can do it. Be strong and do the work. David gave him the plan. And says, now, here are the plans. And all this I have from the hand of the Lord. He gave me understanding. I happen to believe that not only does God want to give us encouragement and direction, but God wants you to be careful who you receive in direction from. There's a last phrase right there which says, all this I have from the hand of the Lord. Now, how many of you know that not everything that glitters is gold?
Amen.